my shame. Who could carry that kind of weight? It was my turn till I made. Good morning, good morning. It is time for Ridgewood Live. So glad that you have chosen Ridgewood as your place of worship this morning. We want to encourage you to go ahead, grab your Bibles, grab your journal, get in and get settled in, because we're going to have a great morning of worship, and then we're going to dive deeper into Acts chapter 2. If you want to go ahead and get your Bible set, Acts chapter 2 is where we're going to be. When you get in, say hello. Let us know who's watching. We'd love to say hello to you. For those of you just now tuning in, good morning, good morning. Say hello when you get in and get signed in. We also want to encourage you just to take a little bit of time and go ahead and share this broadcast. Hit that share button right now. Let's get it out on your Facebook wall so that all of your friends and all of your family can have it. Hit that share button right now. Let's get it out on your Facebook wall so that all...
Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Good morning. Good morning. Hey, it is sun shining today. You got to have your glasses. It is an absolute gorgeous day here in the heart of the Arkansas Delta. The sun is out. The snow is melting. Everybody say amen to that, okay? You got to have these bad boys if you're going to go outside because it is seriously bright. Man, I am so glad to be with you this morning. Thank you so much for tuning in and for making this your choice of worship. It is going to be an amazing day. I tell you what, it looks like that we're going to be able to get out of our driveways and to get out at least by tomorrow, Tuesday for sure. And so I am so thankful that we have got this past week behind us. I'm so thankful that the snow has stopped, the ice has stopped. The temperatures are extremely warm and they're only going to get warmer as the days come on in this coming week. So thank you. Thank you for being here. Thank you for being patient. We just ask you at this point just to kind of tune everything out. Shut off the TV. If you don't have this broadcast already on your television, go ahead and turn your TV off. Turn off all the other devices. And let's just focus in on what God has for us this day. We're going to sing here just a little bit. We're going to have just a time of worship. And then we're going to finish up our series on the seismic shift. I hope that God has spoken to you through this passage of scripture. It is so powerful. It's so vital that we do understand exactly what's going on and what took place on that day of Pentecost. And so we have just spent an enormous amount of time, if you will, trying to dissect it and trying to get it ready and to so that we can understand it. But hey, it is a good day. It is a good day. And so here's what I want you to do. We're going to open with prayer, and then I want you to go ahead and get your Bibles and get those Bibles set out. We're going to be in Acts chapter 2, and then we're going to worship today. I will pretty much believe all the songs we're going to do today, you're going to know. And so right where you are in your homes, I want you just to sing and sing with me as we just worship our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Will you pray with me this morning as we begin? Father, we love you so much. We thank you for this opportunity to gather this morning. We thank you for those that are on. We thank you for those that are going to be watching in the future. And Father, we just pray that you will just eliminate all the distractions that's around us. Father, that you would speak to us right here through the absolute blessing of technology, Lord, that you will speak to us loud and clear. Father, we love you. We thank you for what you're doing. And Father, we thank you for what you're going to do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Folks, again, it is good to have you. Thank you for being here. Here's what I'd like for you to do this morning as we begin our worship. Right here in the comment section, I would like for you just to go ahead and just fill in this blank. Today, I am thankful for. Boom. Today, I am thankful for. And then you fill in that blank. Can you do that this morning? Fill in that blank as we worship.
As you are before your time to worship. Come, now is the time to give your heart. Come, yeah, just as you are to worship. Come, just as you are before.
It just come just as you are to worship him this morning. All right, we're going to continue our worship this morning. Sing it out, sing loud this morning. We are going to know this one, I can assure you. Beautiful old hymn of the faith. So sing it out this morning.
God sent His Son, they called Him Jesus. He came to love, heal and forgive. He lived and died to buy my pardon. And is there to prove my Savior lives? Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I just because He lives, how sweet to hold a newborn baby and feel the pride and joy He gives. But greater still, the child can face uncertain days because He lives.
Sing it out.
Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Because He lives, all fear is gone. Because I is worth the living just because He lives. And then one day I'll cross that river, I'll find life's final war with pain. And then as death gives way to victory, oh, I'll see the lights of glory, and I know He lives. Because He lives, I can face tomorrow. Oh, because He lives, all fear is gone. I know He holds the future, and life is worth the living just because He lives. And life is worth the living just because He lives.
Oh, amen. Amen. And amen. You know, this past week we've been kind of hit with a lot of issues and a lot of things that have challenged us and just made us rethink some things and to be appreciative of things. Well, here's the deal. None of this has caught God off guard. Everything is in His divine plan. And you know something? It's okay. It is okay. It is well with my soul. And I think that should be our mantra as we move forward. Sing it out.
When peace like a river attendeth my way, when sorrows like sea billows roll, whatever my lot, Thou hast taught me to say, it is well, it is well with my soul. Clouds be rolled back as a scroll.
Listen to this.
The trump shall resound, and the Lord shall descend. Even so, it is well with my soul. My soul, it is well, it is well with my soul.
Oh, amen. Love, love, love that song. Love it, love it, love it. Hey, we're going to continue our worship this morning because not only is it well with my soul, not only is it well with where we are and what things are going on in our life and in different situations, do you know that the greatness of our God has never changed? Has never changed. He's still on His throne. He is still sovereign. He is still in control. Let's sing.
Splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide, and trembles at His voice. Trembles at His voice. How great is our God. Oh, sing with me. How great is our God. And all will see how great is our God. Age to age He stands. And time is in His hands, beginning and the end, beginning and the end. The Godhead three in one, Father, Spirit, Son. lion and bull lamb. How great is our God. Oh, sing me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great, how great is our God. You're the name above all names. You're worthy of all praise. And my heart will sing, how great is our God. Our God, sing with me, how great is our God, and oh, see how great is our God. How great is our God, oh, sing with me, how great is our God, and oh, how great is our God.
Sing it one more time.
How great is our God. Oh, sing with me, how great is our God. And oh, see how great, how great is our God.
Ooh. And all of God's people said, amen and amen. What a great song. What a great time of worship this morning. I know that this could be somewhat awkward with you being at home and watching on TV and you know, just thinking, well, this is, you know, this is not church, or I'm not there singing. Get that notion out of your noggin, okay? Just go ahead and get that out, because I can assure you, we're having church, folks. We are having church. You at home, me at home, we singing. God's word is the same in my house as it is in your house. Amen. And so we've got to understand that it is church that we're having, and it is a pleasure to have you here. When you have gotten on, I do hope that you have had a chance to say hello to everyone. I do hope that you had a chance to share this broadcast. If you have not, go ahead right now and hit that little share button. That's there, because that is our way of getting it out even farther and farther here into the Delta and beyond. Okay. And so every time that you share one of these broadcasts, that is your part of the ministry as to sharing the gospel that's out there. We're going to just pray real quick this morning, and then we are headed over to see exactly the aftershocks of Acts 2:42. Let's pray this morning. Father God, we love you. We praise your name. Father, we lift you high. It is you that we sing to. It is you that we pray to. It is you that we glorify. Father, at this time, we ask you just to help us to get through the noise. And Father, to cut through the white noise so that we can hear you. Love that quiet, that still small voice is what we're looking for. Father, we give this to you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Go ahead and get your Bibles already turned on over to Acts 2:42. You know, one of the greatest definitions of insanity, now, I think I posted this yesterday. one of the greatest definitions of insanity is doing the same thing over and over and over again and expecting different results. Hear this, church. If we want God to do something new in our life, then we, you and me, we have to stop doing the same old things. I mean, it's just that simple. If we want God to do something new in our life, then we have to stop doing the same old things. The same thing is true for the church. If we want God to do something new in the church, then we, the church, have to stop doing the same old things. Amen. You hit that heart button. Let me know you're hearing this, okay? Hit that. Hit that out there. We've got to make changes, okay? You see, according to the United States Geological Survey, the larger the main shock of an earthquake, the larger and more numerous the aftershocks are going to be, and the longer that they are going to continue. These aftershocks, okay, are earthquakes in and of themselves, and they follow the largest shock of an earthquake sequence, and they're generally smaller in intensity than the main one. Aftershocks can continue over a period of weeks or months or even years. The main shock, if you will, the main earthquake that took place in Acts chapter 2 was a power that hit this earth the likes that we have never seen before. Now, our kids, Tab, Devin, Colson, they are Marvel movie fanatics. I mean, they love the Marvel movie line, the Marvel universe. And Miss Denise and I enjoy watching them as well. We really do. And they're filled with superheroes with different kinds of powers that will enable them to do this or to be able to do that. And if you've watched them, you know exactly what I'm talking about. Or there's different superheroes that you may have watched or watched even currently. But here what I'm saying. If we were able, somehow miraculously, to harness all of the powers of all of the heroes that's in the Marvel Universe, and if we were to add to that all of the powers of all of the superheroes we've ever known in our life, and all of the powers of every superhero that Hollywood could even fathom, okay? And we were to roll that all up into one, it would not be a drop in the bucket. I mean, it wouldn't even hold a candle to the supernatural power that was unleashed on the day of Pentecost. And we have to understand that. We have to understand the magnitude of what took place on the day of Pentecost. When the convicting power of the Holy Spirit arrived on the day of Pentecost, this ground-shaking, life-changing, main shock event set forth in motion a series of aftershocks that have continued for centuries. You see, every time, now hear what I'm saying, church. Every time that someone is saved, there is an aftershock in the pages of eternity, because that's one more victory over an enemy that has been backpedaling ever since resurrection morning. One more aftershock. The more people that come to Christ, the greater the aftershocks. Amen. In Acts 2, change was taking place. In Acts 2, the aftershocks had begun. On the day of Pentecost, there were some 3,000 common, everyday, ordinary people that wanted something new in their life, and they stopped doing the old things. The result has been sending aftershocks throughout history. Let's look at our primary text. I'm at Acts 2, and I'm going to pick up at verse 38 this morning. Acts 2, beginning at verse 38. Then Peter said to them, "Repent, and let every one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission," or for the forgiveness of sins, "and you shall receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For the promise is to you and to your children and to all who are afar off, as many as the Lord our God will call." Whoo, amen. And with many other words, he testified and he exhorted them, saying, be saved from this perverse generation. Then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. You catch that? And they, the 3,000 new believers, they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and in their fellowship and in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Oh, but then it goes deeper. You see, then it goes deeper. I want you to look at the very next word that we see. It's that very first word in Acts 2:43. Are you looking at it? Are you looking at it? What is that word? That very first word in Acts 2:43 is then. Then. Let's read verse 42 one more time, okay? Verse 42. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship, in the breaking of bread and in prayers. Then. Oh my goodness, then. You see, in other words, because of the actions of the new believers in verse 42, something was about to happen. There was something that was about to take place. Let's keep reading. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods. Let's understand that word sold here. Okay, that word sold here really breaks down to mean would sell. In other words, it was the intent of the heart that they would sell their possessions, and did sell their possessions and goods, and divided them or passed them out among all as anyone had need. Verse 46. So continuing daily, underline that, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they had food. They ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. Oh, holy smokes. The aftershocks are now beginning. See, what we're seeing in these verses that we just read is a new lifestyle. It is a new standard. It is that new reality that was formed because of their life change. What we just read in verses 43 through the first part of verse 47, we can describe it in three words. It's very plain. If you're a note taker, this is for you. This is something you might want to jot down in the margin of your Bible as well, because in these verses from verse 43 through verse 47, we see three words, and they are unity. We see unity. We see compassion. We see unity, compassion, and we see commitment. Unity, compassion, and commitment. Look at the unity that is seen right here in these passages of Scripture. Verse 44 tells us that now all who believed were together. So that we're together. Unity. Verse 45. They sold, or they would sell their possessions. Plural. They would sell their possessions. Verse 46. They continued daily with one accord. They did it as one. They were one body. As one. They shared their meals together with gladness and simplicity of heart. Praising God, having favor with all the people. Unity is screaming off the pages of this text. It is the bedrock of the church today. A church without unity is not going to give a lasting impact in their community. No unity, the church is doomed. Unity is the foundation. As we come together as one with one God, the bedrock
of the church. It starts with unity. Second word was compassion. What do we see in this compassion? Verse 45. Well, this group sold or would sell their possessions. They did so and would do so to provide money for those that were in need. You see, these early Christians held their own possessions lightly. They looked upon their goods as lightly, and they were ready to use them at any moment for someone else as the needs arose. The first church right here in Acts chapter 2 was more concerned about others than they were themselves. Folks, we got to get back to that. We've got to get back to that. Unity, compassion. They were selfless in every aspect of the definition. We have to model that. And the final one was commitment. Commitment was the fabric that held it all together. They were committed to making sure that no one had any need. That meant even selling their own possessions. Now, folks, that's commitment. That's commitment to the gospel. It is commitment to one another, and it is commitment to the mission. We must never forget our mission. Let's understand that. This is a great time for us at Ridgewood to understand this. You see, it's never been about a building. It never has been. And beginning last March, we understood that it was never going to the church. We are the church. We're to be the church. And now, even with the situations as to what's going on, we're thrust right back into it that we, you and I, we are the church, but it is the mission of the gospel that has not deviated. And so even though that we're going to be temporarily here online for a while, and that's going to be our means of worship. That's going to be our means of Bible study. That's going to be our means of communication. Our means of fellowship is going to be right here online. The mission of God has not deviated. And so we have to maintain the focus of the mission, which is the sharing of the gospel to a lost and dying world. Amen. That's what we have to do. The early church was all together, continuing daily with one accord. They made sure that nothing else was more important, okay, than being together as the church. With us, we're being together this morning. You're in your house, I'm in mine, but we're together, okay? We're together. Aren't you thankful for technology? Aren't you thankful for technology? I am overwhelmed by what technology can do. And I'm just going to be honest with you. As much as I'm a nerd, and I am a nerd, I don't know the tip of the iceberg as to what technology is capable of for the sharing of the gospel. And that's why I'm a sponge. I'm trying to learn. I'm trying to do as much as I can, to learn as much as I can, so that we can use this for the spread of the gospel. I encourage you to do the same thing. I so encourage you to do the same thing. We eat meals together. I'm ready to get the snow off the ground. I'm ready to get COVID behind us so that we can hang out. I'm ready to go grab coffee together, to sit down and enjoy one another's company. I'm ready to sit down and to be with you. And I know you are ready to be with each other. And it's having an attitude of gladness and having a simplicity of heart. It's praising God together. Church, that's commitment. And that's where we are, okay? That is where we are. One of the saddest things that's taking place in our country today, and it has been progressively getting worse, okay? But it's heartbreaking to me, is that Christians today, if they are truly Christians, will put anything in the place of their commitment to church. You see, for decades, commitment to the church has steadily dropped. Statistics prove that, and it continues today. Today, in today's world, today's society, church commitment is nothing more than an option on a buffet of other things to do. Now let's hear what I'm about to say, okay? We can talk a good commitment. We can talk a good commitment, but actions speak louder than words. Okay? We can talk that commitment all day long, but your actions speak louder than words. You see, the Jerusalem church was joyful. They were productive. They were loving. They were, and you can just fill in the blank with any more, you know, adjectives that you want to, because their single focus was on Jesus Christ. Their single focus was on Jesus Christ. You see, they were so in love, so captivated, so consumed with Jesus that everything else became secondary. And the result was mind-blowing. It was the results that triggered all of these aftershocks that we're still seeing today. You see, when Jesus Christ is first in your life, okay, hear what I'm saying. When Jesus Christ is first in your life, you can't help but be a part of and attend church and be involved in it any way that you possibly can. Whether it's here online, whether it's in person when we get back in our complex, whether it is serving here, doing there, it's giving of yourself. It's being willing to say, I'm coming out of my comfort zone to do what is necessary for the spread of the gospel. When Jesus is first in your life, when Jesus is first in your life, you can't help yourself from helping others. That's a hard statement to swallow. When he's first in your life, you can't help yourself from helping others. When he's first in your life, you can't stop yourself from praying. You just got to do it. And I'm going to tell you something. When Jesus is first in your life, tithing's not a question. It's going to happen. You're going to give the first fruits of your income. You're going to write that 10% check and more because Jesus is first in your life, and you're going to understand that giving back is part of worship. It's not giving because it's a due, not giving because it's a fee. It's giving because it's worship. You see, all of this, it is and it always has been a heart issue. It's a heart issue. Okay, let me just put it to you like this. If Larry Jones or one of you other men that can handle a saw and nail and all that good stuff, if you're given a set of blueprints, and I mean it's a perfect blueprint, and you have got this, well, that blueprint is going to give you the instructions as to how to build a perfect building. And if there is a mistake, okay, if there's a mistake in that building, then Larry or one of you guys could go back to that blueprint in order to find the problem. Now, you see, I'm not putting my name in there because I can't even drive a nail in straight. But I guarantee you, men like Larry Jones can build anything. And these guys can go back to that blueprint and say, I missed it. That's where I made the mistake. Incorrect mistake. If Miss D, Miss Pat, or man, all kinds of you ladies are given a recipe, and I'm talking a perfect, perfected recipe to bake the perfect desserts, and you follow it to the letter, then there's a great chance that you're going to pop out of that oven a perfect item. And if something is wrong, then you can go back to that recipe and see exactly what might have been left out, what you put too much in. Maybe you left it in the oven too long, but you can figure out what went wrong. You see, the same as it is with the health and the growth of the church. We've been given a perfect diagram, a perfect blueprint, a perfect recipe, if you will, as to what we need to be doing daily as his church. And we find that in Acts 2:43 through 40, or 42 through 47, we find that it's not rocket science, folks. It's really quite simplistic. And you see, when you do that, you ladies, when you bake desserts and you pull that bad boy out of the oven and the aroma smacks you right in the mouth and your mouth starts watering and you can't wait to set that dude down and grab a knife and slice that up because chances are it's better warmer just coming out of the oven than it is colder. Or when you have built that house, when you guys have built something with your hands and you have built whatever it may be and you can sit back and you can look at it and you can understand exactly what's going on. For me, being the nerd that I am, when I can construct anything on a computer graphics or anything like that, I can sit back and go, man, oh man. And you revel in that. Okay. You see, when that plan is done correctly, you get major results because Matt, the first bite of that pie that comes out of that oven and it's still warm. Can't you taste it right now? The result. Or flawless. The results in Scripture are just as flawless. Look with me now at the end of verse 47. At the end of verse 47. Actually, what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up verse 46 because I want you to see the impact. I want you to understand exactly what is taking place here. Are you ready? Verse 46. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And got it? And it's a continuation of what we've just read. Ready for this? And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. The results of following what God has set forth as the blueprint, the layout, if you will, the recipe. You see, when we follow what God has laid out for His church, and guys, we know we're the church. I mean, Matthew 16:18 tells us this. We know that He alone, God alone, is the architect. He is the builder. He is the owner. He is the Lord of the church. We, the believers, the church, we are the called out ones. When we, His church, follow His instructions, we see the results. And the Lord added to the church daily. You see, we are in a mindset. We're in a mindset to think that, well, people can only get saved on Sundays when they come to church. That's just bogus. That's a lie from the pits of hell. Let's understand something real quick, okay? There is 24 hours a day. There are 60 minutes in every hour. There are 60 seconds in every minute. You do the math. God can and will save anyone who calls upon Him and asks forgiveness and gives their life to Him any second of any minute of any hour of any day of any week of any month of any year. It does not have to be on Sunday mornings. God is in the saving business. It's not changed. And the Lord added to the church daily. 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 I can't stress that enough. Daily. Those who were being saved. You see, the results are here. It's waiting on us to put it together. It's always been here. There's nothing changed. There's nothing deviated from Scripture. You know, I'm a very avid reader. Most of you know this. And when I'm in a reading pattern, I generally read one book a week. I like to read 50 books a year at minimum. And I have read seemingly every book on church health, on church growth. And I love it. I really do, because there's always something I can pick up, I can glean, I can do something for it. But at the end of the day, the perfect formula, if you want to use that word, that earthly word, that perfect recipe for church health and church growth is in Acts chapter 2. You can't deviate from this. It's like leaving flour out of a cake. You take one thing out and it's a flop. It's going to fail. You fail to put a 2x4 in the right place in a building, that dude's going to crumble. I mean, it's just going to happen. Every church on the planet needs to go to Acts 2 and needs to have a heart-to-heart with Jesus about it. And that's one of the reasons why the guys just directed me so strong to come here over the past several weeks. And now we understand why. We are the church have got to get back to the original recipe, if you will. The original direction, the original guidelines that the Bible has set forth for church growth. We can trace back. Just like when you're missing flour in a cake, we can trace back what we're missing. So let's ask ourselves this question, okay? Let's get personal this morning. How are you doing continuing steadfastly in the gospel? How you doing? I'm not saying this to be ugly. I'm not saying this to point fingers. I'm asking you in reality because I care about you and I want you to be able to go to these list these guidelines and to let's get back on track. Let's get that recipe right. How are you doing? Continuing steadfastly in the gospel. How are you doing continuing steadfastly doing life together in fellowship? Now, yeah, I know we're in a COVID world. I get that. But we can deviate from that in order to make it happen. How are you doing continuing in fellowship? How are you doing continuing steadfastly, making sure that there is nothing standing in the way of you being all in, having the communion with God? You remember a couple weeks ago when we talked about communion with God and actually coming to God and making sure everything is out of the way, you have confessed everything. I mean, you are bare bones naked in front of God. How are you doing with that? How are you doing? How are you doing continuing steadfastly in your communication, in your love letters to God? How you doing? How you doing? How many times have I said this, much less how many times have you heard this? If we always do what we've always done, we'll always get what we've always got. It happens in your life. It happens in the life of your family, and it happens in the life of your church. If we always do what we've always done, we will always get what we've always got. Don't you think that it's probably time that we rethink what we're doing? Personally, as a family, and as a church, don't you think that it's time to rethink it? I believe without question that we are on the threshold of a monumental, continuous sessions of aftershocks of people coming to Jesus for salvation. I believe revival is just on the other side of the threshold. I believe it's here. I believe that God is ready to radically change the spiritual landscape of the Delta and to pour out His grace and His mercy and His forgiveness in an unprecedented manner, but He is waiting on His church, that's you, that's me, to get our priorities straight and to get our commitment in line with Him. For the church to successfully impact their area with the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now hear what I'm saying, okay? Do not miss this. For the church to successfully impact their area with the gospel, then Christians have to love, have to live, and have to sound more like Jesus Christ than they do a political candidate of their choice. Amen and amen. You see, and when we do that, when our lives reflect Jesus Christ, when our lives reflect Jesus and our love and our commitment to Him, you see, folks, nothing Scripture teaches this. Nothing at all, ever, nothing can separate you or me from the love of God. Nothing can separate us from God's love, but there is a plethora of things that can separate our love from Him. And so when our lives reflect Jesus and our love and our commitment to Him, it goes back to that song. All will see how great is our God. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were being saved. It's time for the ground shaking to begin. Will you pray with me this morning? Father, your word is just powerful. It is alive. It is vibrant. And Father, it is so needed today. God, may we hang on to every word that is in Scripture. May we not lose sight of one single word, because every word is there for a reason. God, this day, most of us that are listening, most of us that are going to watch this in the future, need to make some changes. We need to get some things organized. We need to get some things in an orderly manner. And Father, this is not a condemning message. This is a motivational message. This is to see where we are and what we're doing and to get it right. Because Father, you want us to get it right. You want us to have that perfect love, that reflection of you to the world around us. Because Father, there's no doubt in my mind you're wanting to do something crazy big right here. There's no doubt. Father, I've known it for a long time. Father, this day, if there is anybody that hears this message, God, that does not know you as their personal Savior, Father, I just pray that they will hear your call and that they will give their life to you. Father, that they will walk away from being that old man or that old woman, and that they will wrap their arms around you, and Father, that you will give them that brand new heart, and they would become that new man and that new woman in Christ Jesus. And Father, for those of us that are believers, that Father, we just need to go back to the blueprint. We need to go back to the recipe. See what's going on. God, may we dive so deep into your word that the enemy just can't even get close to us. God, we pray for revival to take place. We pray for a spiritual awakening right here in the Delta. Father, in our country's capital, in D.C. Oh God, it is all you. Father, please forgive me for all my sins. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Ooh, folks, thank you so much for being a part of Ridgewood Live today. Just got a few things I want to share with you. Really hang around with me, okay, because I've got a couple things I want to share with you about our building. Number one is, if you have not already gathered this, all services for the time being are going to be online. That's Wednesdays, of course, Sunday mornings. Everything we do will be online. Miss Pat and her Sunday school class on Thursdays is going to resume in the near future, okay? But right now, it is going to be suspended. So we'll be looking and getting ready for Miss Pat as soon as we can. All activities, anything going on at the church, is suspended for the time being as we get our building back in order. And so if you do need me, okay, if you need me, you can call me if you have my number. Okay. You can shoot me a text. You can message me here on Facebook. You can send me an email. My email is ridgewoodpastor@gmail.com. ridgewoodpastor@gmail.com. If you need Gloria, okay. Gloria has set up her office in her house. Gloria will be able to do everything that she was doing in the church complex at her house. We've made sure of that. We're getting everything in. If you need her, you can call her, you can text her, you can message her here on Facebook. Her email is secretary@ridgewoodbaptistar.org. That's secretary@ridgewoodbaptistar.org. So Gloria and I are absolutely available at your fingertips. Not a problem. All you got to do is just reach out to us. I will be here at my home office. Gloria will be there at her home office. Before I forget it, okay, we will be mailing out Sunday school material and your devotions. For those of you who have been getting devotional books, the open windows, the journeys, the stand firms, all of those. And for your Sunday school books, we will be getting those out to you. We are waiting on those to come in. Okay. And as soon as they arrive, then we will get those out into the mail. All right. If you do not normally get one and you'd like one, contact Gloria and we will make sure that you get whatever it is that you need. So you want to reach out to her and to do that. Okay. Finally, we need you to be very faithful in your giving. Okay. We want you to be very faithful in your mailing in or your sending in of your tithes and your offerings. Because we're not in the building, you can't bring those to the services on Sunday. But you can mail those in. You can just drop a check in the mail to Ridgewood P.O. Box 785 here in Forest City, 72336. P.O. Box 785. Forest City 72336. Or if you really want to make this simple, you can give online. We have an amazing system set up. You can go to our website, lovemyrbc.com, lovemyrbc.com, and click on online giving. And it will take you directly to the portal so that you can send in your tithes and your offerings. You can even send in your traction. Anything you need to do, you can do all of that online. And you can do that one time, like if you want to do it this week. Or you can set that up so that it would be done every week and have it already taken out of your account. Whatever is best for you, but that is available. So mail in your tithes or your offerings, or let's do that online, lovemyrbc.com, and click on online giving. If you're new to us, And this is your first time together with us, we thank you so much. And if you are on here and if you have made a decision for Christ, if you've given your life to Christ, if you have rededicated your life, if you've just felt God doing some things in your life and you just wanted to share, then I want to encourage you to go to lovemyrbc.com. And this is right across the top there. And click on guest card. Click on guest card. And if you're new to us, just fill that out. It takes about 2 minutes. And that way we'll have a record of your attendance. If you have made a decision, do this same thing, okay? Let us know who you are. And there at the bottom, it's going to give you the opportunity to let us know exactly what your decision was. We want to rejoice with you. We want to praise the Lord with you. So if you are new to us or if you have made a decision, lovemyrbc.com and click on guest card. And that will give you the tool in order to let us know. Finally, one quick word and update about our complex. Right now, we have got several of our men, a couple of our deacons for sure, are actually at the church complex and they are meeting with the company that is actually going to do the lion's share of the cleanup in the building. They are there right now. They are getting, I would assume big drying fans. They're trying to dry it out as much as possible. So I know Brother Johnny, Brother Larry, and I'm not real sure who else is there, but they are on campus right now and they are finding out what all is going to be going on, trying to get a game plan, so on and so forth. And so they are there today. This afternoon, I'm meeting with the deacons and I'm meeting with Brother Norville, the building and grounds, and we are going to meet together to really get our heads together so that we can develop and determine the game plan as to how we are going to proceed. And so whatever comes out of that meeting, I will let you know. Okay, I will come back and I will tell you. Well, it won't be another live tonight, but when we get our priorities straight and get our to-do list done, we will come back and we will share with you exactly what's going on and how this is going to work. We have been in contact with our insurance company, and we do have a reference number, and it's claim number. And so we are waiting on the adjuster to get here to go over and to see the entire campus, to take a look at it. And so that's kind of where we are. So the cleanup crew is there now, kind of making an assessment, getting some drying units in. And then the leadership will be meeting this afternoon to develop the game plan. And then the first thing first is we got to get the adjuster in here. And so when we get all that done, then we will be ready to get back and to let you know where we are, what's going to go on, and maybe we can kind of give some sort of a timeline, okay? That's what we're hoping for. But that is where we are. That is the update. We don't know anything else other than that. Lastly, this has been a powerful series, okay? Seismic Shift has been a powerful series. We've got another really, really strong series that I believe God is drawing us to that, Lord willing, we're going to begin this coming Sunday. As soon as I can kind of iron out a few more things, make sure 100% that's where the Lord's going, then I will let you know this week. But if it's where I think we're going, holy cow. So just get ready for the announcement that's coming. I want to encourage you to make sure that you are checking this page regularly. Make sure, if you're looking at this on your phone, there is a button. When you go back just to the page, there is a button underneath the Facebook header should have three little dots to it. And if you will click on that button, then it will bring up a couple of sets of choices. And one of those choices is notifications. And you need to check that box of notifications, and it's going to give you different things to choose from. And chances are you are only receiving the highlighted statuses or highlighted video or highlighted live video. You want to check that. If it says highlighted, you want to check that and change it to all so that you get a notice for all statuses, all video, and all live video. So if you'll do that, then that way you'll be sure to get notices as to what pops up here on this page. Folks, that is all I have got today. Thank you so much for making Ridgewood your place of worship. If you need anything, do not hesitate to reach out to me, to reach out to Gloria. Get your ties in. Use those mechanisms. Pam's already got this listed. Thank you very much, Pam, for what you do. Let me see here. As soon as we hear this afternoon, kind of get a game plan, we'll be sharing. Brother Larry will be with me Tuesday night for our Zoom Sunday School class. You can watch it right here on Facebook Live. We're having a blast, by the way. And since we're kind of out of pocket right now, this is a great way for you to have Sunday School. So Sunday School Tuesday night at 7 o'clock. And then, Lord willing, I'll be back tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. for our Monday morning coffee chat. Folks, I am out of here. Be safe if you do attempt to get out. All right? Be safe. In the meantime, I'm out of here. I love you guys so very much. We'll talk soon. Bye-bye, guys.